This is Sports Talk with Phil Kornblut and Chris Bergen. Sports Talk is heard across the state on radio affiliates of the Sports Talk Media Network and is streaming live on SportsTalkSC.com, as well as Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. The South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number to call in is 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now, here are Phil and Chris with tonight's edition of Sports Talk.
And good evening, everybody, and welcome into Sports Talk, Sports Talk Media Network on a fine, fabulous Friday all across the state of South Carolina. Chris Bergen in the undisclosed Grand Strand location for this evening, heading into a busy, busy baseball weekend. Phil Kornblut will join us momentarily. He is live up in Clemson, watched practice a bit earlier today, Tigers and the Florida Gators, game one of the Super Regionals coming up tomorrow afternoon. Game two will be Sunday afternoon, and game three, if necessary, set for Monday at some point in time. If you'd like to be on the program tonight, we've got a busy show, 888-898-2525. Again, 888-898-2525, the Sports Talk SC Education Lottery lucky number available for you. We'll try and squeeze in a few calls as we move through the next 2 hours, but if you're familiar with the program on Fridays, normally don't have a whole lot of room to slide in callers, usually guest heavy, and that is no exception tonight. As a matter of fact, set to join us in about 10 minutes, we will catch up with John Whittle of the Big Spur. He's got the latest on the coaching search over at South Carolina, actually reporting today on the baseball side that he said Ray Tanner has spoken with both Chris Pollard of Duke, along with Dan McDonald of Louisville and Tom Walter of Wake Forest. John goes on to say that Ray Tanner has also had a conversation with North Greenville head coach and Gamecock standout Landon Powell. So we will find out the latest on the coaching search. That's about the biggest news of the day, just whom the Gamecocks have talked with. No mention of Cliff Godwin in that, at least in John's report from today. Find out if he has been somebody that they have touched on, some of the other candidates as well. John's set to join us here in about 10 minutes. Also, we will hear from the interested parties up at Clemson. We'll hear from Eric Backich and also Kevin O'Sullivan, the two head coaches, as the Tigers and Gators get set to meet in baseball for the first time in a long, long time. For whatever reason, these two programs rarely meet in anything. Certainly baseball, it's been, about 4 decades since they last played. So we'll get both coaches' perspective. And, of course, there is a homecoming of sorts for Kevin O'Sullivan going back to Clemson, where he cut his teeth as an assistant, now a very, very fine head coach at Florida. So we'll hear from both of them coming up on the program later as we move through the evening. Also on the show, as per normal, coming up at about 7:15 tonight, we'll get inside the fast lane with Jeff Owens, talk some NASCAR racing, and just after 7:30, bogeys, birdies, and biceps all around the state of South Carolina with George Bryan. But speaking of the baseball, in case you missed it earlier today, and please, if you have an answer, we'll get Phil on here in just a second. He may be able to shed some light. But why there is a run rule in college softball in the NCAA tournament, but there's not one in the NCAA baseball tournament, and the reason I bring that up to you is Exhibit A today, Florida State 24, UConn 4. Now, that 20-run deficit for UConn makes it sound like they were actually competitive in the game. It wasn't that close. Florida State got 24 runs on 18 base hits today. And for whatever reason, they had to play all 9 innings today. I'm still baffled by that. It makes zero sense for that at all. So Florida State, one win away from heading back to the College World Series. Also, Tennessee in progress right now, top half of the 9th inning. They're trying to go up 1-0 on Evansville. Up in Knoxville, the number one overall seed, struggled early. Evansville actually had an early lead, but the Volunteers have broken out the bats in Tennessee again in the top of the 9th, trying to finish off Evansville to grab a 1-0 lead. Just getting started up in Chapel Hill, one of the super regionals there, as North Carolina and West Virginia are scoreless going to the bottom half of the 1st inning. And in just a little bit, Kansas State will square off with Virginia. And those are the 4 super regionals today. And then we will have the 4 tomorrow, which of course includes Florida and Clemson. All right, 888-898-2525. That gets us rolling on this Friday evening. And Josh, do we have Phil hooked in with us now?
We don't. He said it was he said he thought it was 5 o'clock, and as we all know, it's 6 o'clock. He had the equipment still in his car whenever I caught him at right at 6:04. So, not yet. I mean to call him out or anything, but you know, it's just how it goes on this travel day to Clemson.
Phil, you know, old age, it gets us all. And Father Time is undefeated. But that may be the worst excuse I've ever heard from him.
Yeah.
I mean, all the excuses, and Phil is notoriously, time is not a big factor in his life, never has been, but he always seems to show up right on time. Being early is not necessarily a function of his ability in radio. He's a fine, fine broadcaster. But we got to get him a watch.
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't leave the state. And he knows the state of South Carolina is in Eastern time. How in the world did he cross-reference and figured it was 5 o'clock not 6?
He said his computer said it was 5 o'clock. So I don't know what's going on with his computer.
Has he not used his laptop since he was in Birmingham for the SEC tournament?
He uses it every night.
That may actually be it.
He uses it every night, Chris. He uses it every night. I don't know. We'll have to hear it from him. I have no clue.
Oh, my goodness me. Phil. Oh, well, folks, you bet best laid plans. That's why we sent Phil to Clemson, so we'd have him there to give us the up-to-date information and everything going on. So while we wait on Phil here, Josh, you want to go ahead and get John Whittle up on board with us?
I'll do that right now.
With him. Let's go ahead and do that. And we'll go ahead and get this knocked out, have some time with John Whittle, the big spur again, the big news, at least with regards to the coaching search at South Carolina. Ray Tanner has evidently, according to John, talked with Chris Pollard of Duke, also Dan McDonald of Louisville, Tom Walter of Wake Forest. He's also had a conversation with North Greenville head coach Landon Powell. So those are some of the names, and I don't think you could go wrong with any of those hires. I know there's a lot of folks on either side of the coin. Certainly Phil has laid out, a fine argument this week about promoting Monty Lee, currently the interim head coach, assistant with the Gamecocks, promote him to head coach, and then maybe bring in Jim Tomey and Landon Powell, some of the guys who plug you back into the success that USC baseball has had over the years. You plug them in with Monty Lee, and I think that's a very, very solid coaching staff. But then on the flip side, there is the argument, I get it, that Monty did not have ultimate success at Clemson. But if you look and sort of peel the onion back a little bit further, outside of not getting out of a regional, Monty Lee, especially during the regular season, had tremendous success at Clemson. I mean, he had one season where he won 47 ball games, and had he been a little bit more successful in the postseason, could have had a 50-win season with the Tigers. And then, of course, you have the COVID year and all that kind of stuff factoring in. So for whatever reason, down the stretch, the last couple of years didn't necessarily work out poorly for Monty Lee. But does that mean he shouldn't get another chance at South Carolina, where I think Ray Tanner, as Phil pointed out earlier this week, and John can probably attest to this.
Well, let's hear it from him.
Probably would have hired him had he not just gotten the job at Clemson a year or so when the job came open after Chad Holbrook. So let's head off to the phones and welcome in on the first of many guests tonight on this Friday evening. We say hello to John Whittle of the Big Spur. John, happy Friday to you, my friend. How are you doing tonight?
Doing wonderful. Thank you guys for having me.
Oh, it's our pleasure. No one knows USC athletics any better than you. So when we saw your report a bit earlier today about some of the folks that Ray Tanner has chatted with regards to the coaching search at USC, thought you'd be a perfect guest to kick us off on this Friday. So tell us what you can, what you know about where the search is, I guess, on day 5 now as we hit the end of the week.
Yeah, you know, I don't think it's going to go a crazy lot longer. Like, I think it's, I don't want to say it's winding down, but I think we're getting close to winding down, if that makes sense. You know, there are obviously a handful of folks who Ray wanted to talk to and kind of get to know a little bit and see how things line up, and that's happened over the course of this week. So he's been through that, and I think he's getting ready to kind of narrow some things down.
Of the folks that you've reported today, how is there in any order, do you think, the Chris Pollard, Wake Forest head coach, you know, Duke's head coach and Chris Pollard, some of the guys that you reported today, do you have an inkling as to which might be the leading candidate at this point?
I don't know for sure. I mean, you mentioned those guys, Monty Lee's in there, Cliff Godwin from East Carolina. Dan McDonald from Louisville, Chris Pollard from Duke, Tom Walter from Wake Forest. Those are kind of the guys who I feel like are all in kind of that lead group. I can't tell. I haven't been able to figure out if there's a guy still out there somewhere who might still be playing or you know, we just haven't heard of. I haven't been able to put my finger on any of those kind of guys. I think it's going to come from that group. And I haven't felt good about Godwin or McDonald, taking this thing. So I don't feel like it's going to be one of those two guys. I think it'll come down to the group of Tom Walter and Chris Pollard and Monty Lee.
John, of Dan McDonald and also Cliff Godwin at East Carolina, you said you don't feel good about them. They're not interested. Ray Tanner's not interested in them. What is your sense there?
With Cliff, you know, he's turned down a lot of gigs. Like he's been very passionate about wanting to stay at East Carolina and get them to Omaha. And word in the college baseball world has always been that he would leave for Ole Miss, but that's just about it. And then with Dan McDonald up at Louisville, I know that he wants to kind of cement his legacy up there. They've stumbled a little bit, but Dan McDonald is Louisville baseball, and you know I think he wants to get that program back on top and kind of see that one back versus leaving with it being in a not very good place.
John Whittle of the Big Spur with us here this evening, reporting earlier today that he knows Ray Tanner has chatted with Chris Pollard of Duke, Dan McDonald of Louisville, also Tom Walter of Wake Forest, and Landon Powell of North Greenville. Clearly, he doesn't have to talk to Monty Lee, John. I mean, he visits with him, I would imagine, every day. Make the case for and or against Monty Lee. And I guess my question is, if Monty's the guy, why hasn't he already been announced as head coach?
Well, I don't think he's necessarily the far and away guy. Like I think that Ray's wanted to go through this search process and vet some other candidates and see what kind of options are out there, like you know most athletic directors will do. So like you said, he can kind of talk to Monty whenever he wants to, and he can make that happen whenever he wants to. And I'm sure they've chatted a little bit. You know, they haven't sat down and had a long meeting about, you know, what would you do with this and why did things go wrong here? That to my knowledge has not happened yet. But I do think they've had a few little conversations, little side conversations. And, you know, at the end of the day, like Monty's got to answer the question, like you went to Clemson and you were fired from there. Like, why is it going to be different here? And Monty's going to have to answer that question to Ray Tanner, and he's going to have to sit up there if he gets this job at the introductory press conference, and that's probably question number one that he gets asked. So he's got to be ready to answer that one. And, you know, if he doesn't provide a good answer, he might be the head coach at South Carolina. But he's a South Carolina guy. He's been in this program. He knows what the flaws were here these last 2 years and should have a pretty decent idea of how to fix it. You know, there's something to be said for having a feel for the program, what's going on with it and what it needs. There's something to be said for institutional knowledge and having a great feel for what's going on and what needs to change. So I think those are a few things that are certainly in Monty Lee's favor.
John, do you have an idea as to why maybe it didn't work for him at Clemson? I mean, you look at his first couple of seasons up there, he had things rolling, winning over 40 games, just couldn't ever advance out of the regional. And then the last couple of seasons that he was with the Tigers did not make the NCAA tournament and was ultimately dismissed. Do you have an inkling? You know Monty probably as well as anybody. Do you have an inkling as to why maybe it didn't work for him there?
Yeah, and it's a great question. And that COVID team that they had has two pitchers already in the big leagues and one who was drafted in the third round. That was setting up to be a pretty darn good year for them. But in terms of what happened those last 2 years, like they had issues like a lot of folks did in 2021 with COVID. 22 wasn't good enough, and you know missing the tournament two straight years is really gonna cause you to get a look to be fired. And, you know, they had a new athletics director who felt like he could make a splash higher and made the change. And but yeah, I mean, they certainly stumbled at the end. And I think, in my opinion, I think Monty was a little bit too loyal to some of his assistants. He probably should have made a change at least the pitching coach position earlier than he did. You know, they just, there were a couple of years right there kind of in the middle where they just didn't recruit quite well enough, lost some guys to the draft, missed on some guys, and just didn't quite have the dudes there late in the year. But, you know, he recruited a bunch of those guys that were, you know, winning a lot of games last year. Like there was only one position player, one pitcher on last year's Clemson team that ended up faring pretty well that Monty didn't recruit. And, you know, almost the entire pitching staff this year that was used by the Tigers was recruited by Monty, and about half of the position players. So, you know, he left that program in a decent spot in terms of talent. Just didn't get the opportunity to coach him. But, you know, that's a question that we'll all get the answer to, perhaps, you know, if Monty's hired.
John Whittle of the Big Spur with us for a couple of more moments here on Sports Talk. John, what do you believe Ray Tanner's pitch is to, let's just say, Chris Pollard of Duke? Similar program, maybe not quite the resources. Does he throw more money at Chris Pollard? The success that USC's program historically has had, the SEC, what do you think are his pitches to guys who are currently coaching in the ACC on what I guess you would look at as terms of Power 5 level, pretty much on the same plane?
Yeah, I mean, all of those things that you mentioned. I mean, at the end of the day, like, South Carolina baseball has a great tradition. They've won national championships. The fan base here is extremely passionate. You know, you get to compete in the best league in the country, and honestly, one with plenty of money. You know, is Wake Forest gonna fund, you know, fully fund baseball if you go to 30 full scholarships? Like, that's a question that, you know, programs are going to have to start asking themselves, you know, how are we going to do this in the new landscape of college athletics? And, you know, SEC and Big Ten schools are in, you know, the best position to navigate through some of these things financially. So, you know, there are certainly a lot of things to sell when it comes to South Carolina baseball and South Carolina athletics. It's not necessarily a slam dunk case. Both of those guys have been at those institutions for a really long time, and you don't see baseball coaches hopping around so much when they're content in a place. Look at Cliff Godwin at ECU, for example. So, but you're right. I mean, those are some of the things that you sell.
Another minute or so. How about Landon Powell? How much do you think him coaching at a Division II program, even though he's turned it into a very, very solid one, how much do you think that may help him or probably hurt him in terms of Ray Tanner promoting him and bringing him in as head coach?
Yeah, I mean, I think that certainly hurts him. I mean, you look at who Landon is, and I'm not speaking ill of Landon. You look at who he is and what he's done, what he's accomplished as a player, as a coach. It's incredible. And, you know, I do think that Landon is great at what he does. And I just don't know that if you're South Carolina baseball, if you can make that hire of that coach. Like, I know Ray told him, you know, back when Mark Kingston was eventually hired, like, you really need some D1 experience, like, in some capacity. And, you know, that hasn't happened. So, you know, maybe the Citadel down there, maybe the Winthrop job. It's hard to say. I think he just needs some of that D1 experience. And I know he would argue that point, and I understand where he's coming from. He's had incredible success at that level. He battles D1s for recruits and gets recruits to come to his D2 school over a D1 program. And, you know, he's such a legend here. Like, I hate to speak out on him in a potentially negative way, but I think that at the end of the day, that's just going to prevent him from getting a head coaching job here. I think he would come here as an assistant, and I think that that would be a good hire if whoever the head coach is wants to go down that route. But, you know, I just don't think Ray Tanner is going to make that move.
No, I think that's very fair, and I think Landon would understand that. Last minute or so with you, John, when do you anticipate this coming to a head? Do you see something maybe being announced first of next week, or is it possible this carries and drags on into the following week?
I mean, it wouldn't shock me if it's in the next day or two, to be honest mm-hmm. with you. It wouldn't shock me. I mean, I think they're getting to that point where you start moving quicker. Like, you've had your conversations. You've had the opportunity to figure out what you like, what you don't like, who you think you have the ability to get. I think it's time to start moving pretty quickly, and you need to because the transfer portal's open and kids are starting to visit places and commit places. So you got to move with a sense of urgency, and I think you're at the point where you can if you want to. I wouldn't think it goes past early next week. I think we have to know something by probably Tuesday at the latest, I would think. But, you know, it wouldn't shock me if it happens, a little bit before that. But if it drags on past about Wednesday, then something's gone a little haywire, I think.
You want to be plugged into the Gamecocks, you read John Whittle's stuff at the Big Spur. John, we appreciate the time. Outstanding information. I know you'll be all over this throughout the weekend, and we'll catch up with you again real soon.
Absolutely. Appreciate you having me.
Thank you. That's John Whittle of the Big Spur again talking today that he knows Ray Tanner has chatted with Chris Pollard of Duke, Dan McDonald of Louisville, and also Tom Walter of Wake Forest, along with conversations with Landon Powell and, of course, the current interim head coach Monty Lee. And John believes this will come to a head at some point in time, probably in the next 72, 96 hours. So hopefully we'll know something about Gamecock baseball and the direction of the program going into next week. Meantime, we know what the direction of the Clemson program is. It's headed in the right direction, as is the Florida program. They'll meet in the Super Regionals tomorrow, game one. And up there to cover it for us for Sports Talk, we have rung the dinner bell for him, and he's answered, hello, Phil Kornblut.
Great interview with John. Great interview. Learned a lot listening to John. Everything he said was very informative, and talk more about that in just a moment. I apologize. Josh kind of needs to learn that you don't have to tell all your truths over the air. He could have just said, you know, I was locked in the bathroom, or I was down there finishing a one-on-one with Sully, or I was helping him line the field. To be quite honest with you, I'm sitting here at my computer, and, you know, you have that little clock in the right-hand mm-hmm. corner of your computer. My computer said it was 5:05, and I wasn't paying attention to anything else. I was writing stories, and I was cleaning up audio for tonight's show. I'm looking at the clock, 5:05, et cetera, et cetera. Hadn't looked at my phone or anything like that. So when Josh called me, said, where are you? I said, what do you mean? It's 5:05. He goes, no, it's 6:05. And I said, no. So somehow, I don't know how this happened, somehow inside the settings of my computer, it switched to the central time zone. Now, how can that happen? How does that happen?
I asked Josh, I was wondering if you had not used your laptop since you were in Birmingham for the SEC tournament. That would have made perfect sense.
No,
but Josh says you use it every night, so yeah. I don't know. I really don't know.
That's just bizarre. That's just bizarre. So anyway, I didn't sweat it because I know you were there and Josh was there and you guys can handle it. So that's just hunky-dory. And John
it's
Whittle was great.
It's always better to have you with us, though.
No, not
it's
always.
It's the reason we sent you up there.
I think that, I got stuff coming from here. Don't you worry. We got plenty of good stuff coming from here. But I knew you and John would hit it out of the ballpark, and John always does. We thank him for being with
really
us.
Good.
So we're going to take 5 minutes. I'm going to watch the clock, and we'll be back in 5 minutes.
We'll be right back.
Okay, we're back. It is Sports Talk. Sports Talk Media Network. Phil Kornblut up here at DKS, Doug Kingsmore Stadium, where, Chris Bergen, they do promise to have a party atmosphere up here tomorrow. Eric Bakich is calling for more of the same that they last weekend. He loved it. He wants more of the same. He wants people, of course, they're going to be opening up the softball stadium, which is right behind this facility, so people can sit in there and, I guess, watch it on the big screen in the softball stadium. But he wants people milling around all over the place outside the stadium. Just be here like it's baseball Mardi Gras and create an atmosphere all over this place. Plus, he wants more seats. He said 6,000 people in here last weekend were fantastic. He thinks they could have 10,000 people in here to make it even more fantastic. So maybe
Fire marshal might have a problem with that.
You have a problem with?
No, I said the fire marshal might have problem if they try to
squeeze 10,000
in there. I think
he's talking more seats.
Yeah. You know. He's mentioned that before about expanding Doug Kingsmore Club, DKS.
Yeah. Well, we'll see how it's rocking tomorrow. 2 o'clock will be the first pitch tomorrow. And today both teams worked out on the beautiful grass and the infield, all natural dirt grass, except for the weird warning track, which has no gravel, has grass all the way to the warning track. Of course, a little bit of a hill there. In fact, we asked Kevin O'Sullivan, the Florida coach, who was here with Jack Leggett, of course, and Eric Bakich. Bakich was here for a year, and Tim Corbin. Isn't it something? The two highest paid head baseball coaches in college baseball today were both on that staff. Corbin's number one and Sullivan's number two. But, you know, for visiting teams, and they haven't played, Clemson and Florida have not played since 1983, and that was in Gainesville. So for visiting teams who come in here and they've never played in this facility, the warning track can give you a little bit of a problem because I guess there's no sound under your feet, and all of a sudden you're backtracking, and you're starting to go uphill. If you're not careful, you can lose your balance and make a mistake out there. And, of course, Sullivan knows all about it, and they worked on that this afternoon, and he feels comfortable that his players will be fine out there tomorrow. And the pitching matchups, of course, those have been set, and it will be the freshman Liam Peterson going for Florida, who's a guy that, according to Sullivan, he's a guy that really helped turn their season around. When he started getting it going and becoming a dominating pitcher for them, that's kind of when they picked it up. And so he's going to go tomorrow. It'll be Tristan Smith, left-hander, going for the Tigers. The Tigers opting to hold on to Aiden Canuck and start him on Sunday against Jack Caglione. So, I don't know. Eric Bakich is certainly leaving himself open to the big second guess because you're starting your best pitcher on the second day where you could be trying to stay alive in the Super Regional, whereas if you started him on the first game, you could very well, with a great performance, have yourself a 1-0 lead and try to close things out the second game.
The only thing about that, since they're playing the Saturday, Sunday, Monday situation, if you ran Canuck and started him Saturday just like he pitched last week in the regionals, you really, I think, start to mess up with Tristan Smith because he'd have almost too much rest if there is such a thing going from Friday to pitch to Sunday. So, and, you know, when we had Coach Bakich on, Tuesday, I think it was, on during the week, he kind of hinted that he was pleased with what he saw, and I can't blame him. I thought Tristan Smith pitched very well, and they went over a high point. So I don't know that you penalize him and move him out of his normal first start in the rotation. And you still have Canuck, who I believe is their best pitcher and will be their Friday night guy probably next year, still getting him to go in a game that's either going to be a must-win or you can close it out and go to Omaha. So I think they're still in a pretty good position.
Well, let's just hope the baseball tomorrow is better than what it's been so far today in the
Supers.
The good
news is it can't be worse.
Golly, did Florida State run their football team out there against UConn? I mean, I know they want to impress the College Football Playoff Committee more than they did last year, apparently. 24-4, Florida State over Connecticut. There is no mercy rule in the postseason, so at least at this level of postseason, so you got to suck it up. 24-4, Florida State beats Connecticut, and then Tennessee beat Evansville today 11-6. So, you know, at least, and on paper, you look at those two supers and you think the home teams have got a pretty easy go of it, and they probably do. They probably have a pretty easy go of it, especially based on what we saw today. And then right now, West Virginia is leading at North Carolina 1-0 in the top of the third. And then tomorrow you've got the Kansas State – I'm sorry, tonight you've got Kansas State playing at Virginia. So that's where we are today with the Supers. Going back to – and we're going to hear from Coach Bakich in just a second. And going back to what John Whittle was saying, and he was, of course, well-informed and right on the money with whatever it was he was saying because he knows what he's saying. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if and I heard, I was very interested in what he said, that he thought something could happen by Tuesday. So, you know, looking at the coaches that he talked about, I mean, all three of them are going to cost South Carolina. Here we go back to the money thing again, but I think you have to keep this under consideration. All three of those would cost, I guess, all four of them. Louisville, and of course, he's pretty much ruled Louisville out, and he's pretty much ruled East Carolina out,
yeah,
which would lead
yep.
you to believe Wake Forest and Duke coaches. And, you know, one's older, who's done a lot in a place where, you know, it's they don't have great facilities and all that kind of stuff, but he's done well. But he is an older guy. You know, he's a guy that, and I don't know him at all, obviously, but he could be a guy that you hire and he does a really good job, but you might be having to hire another coach in 3 or 4 years, you know, just because. How old is Coach Walters? Like 60 or something? I think he's like 60. Check me on that. And then, you know, coach at Duke, yeah, I mean, I don't know what it would cost to get him if that's the guy that you decide to go with. And he's obviously done some good things at Duke, but has he done – and, again, I go back to Monty Lee. Has he done at Duke anything more than what Monty did during his time at Charleston and at Clemson? And Whittle is right. You know, Monty's going to have to answer the question about why the bad ending at Clemson, you know, at a place that baseball yeah. is revered and you have the money, what happened. But I also think he kind of answered his question. The COVID year made it difficult for everybody to recruit because you couldn't bring players to campus, you know. That had to hurt you in your next couple of classes. He had that great year, that really good team, as John mentioned, guys who were in the majors on that COVID team that got cut short. Of course, Mark Kingston suffered the same fate. He was having a good season when the season was called off. So, and maybe you could apply the same rationale to Kingston and Columbia, that the COVID year just really kind of set them back. You know, Kingston was able to recover here the last couple of years with what he did, and Monty was not able to recover so quickly with what happened at the end there at Clemson. But I think you look at the entire body of work for what Monty Lee has done, as I mentioned the other night, 65% winning percentage. He's won championships in three different leagues, universally liked in the state by baseball people. He's a state baseball lifer. And he's running your program right now and holding things together at a very difficult time. I don't know what more you could ask of a guy. And then there's also this train of thought for me, again, trying to think like Ray Tanner. If he is thinking this way, I mean, look, he hired Monty Lee once as an assistant coach and loved him, thought the world of him, okay, probably helped him get a job at the College of Charleston. When he gets the Clemson job, and, you know, I kind of get the feeling, and I don't know this for fact, okay? So this is me talking, nobody else. This is just my assessment. I mean, I think that Monty Lee probably looks at Ray Tanner like his baseball daddy. And when he made decisions career-wise, he ran them through Ray Tanner, or he was advised. He ran it by Ray, got advice. When time came to go to Clemson, I got to believe that they talked. And Ray probably advised him to take it. And so when the job came open, when he fired Holbrook, of course, I think Monty was just in his, what, first year at Clemson, had won an ACC championship that first year, et cetera. But it was too soon. It was too soon for anything to happen there. My point is, again, he hired him. He nurtured him. He's advised him. He brought him back into the program. I don't know why you just don't know why you wouldn't hire Monty Lee if you're Ray Tanner and you got that kind of relationship going. Why would you bring an outsider in? So,
well, that's why I asked John if he felt like if Monty was the guy, why hasn't he been announced? And I thought John had a really good answer. He talked about Ray Tanner doing his due diligence and talking to guys like Tom Walter up at Wake Forest, who, by the way, is in his mid-50s.
Looks 60.
And that's what college athletics will do
to you. But you know what? He's never been late for a first pitch, okay? I'll give him that.
We don't know that. And he's a really, really good guy. You'll remember this is the coach who donated a kidney to one of his players. I mean, if you're looking for salt-of-the-earth type people, I'm not sure you can do better.
Wait a minute. Was that
Walter.
A violation? Was that an NCAA violation back
not
then?
Not anymore. It would have been back in the 70s, probably. It would have been a violation. Because he didn't offer it to the general student body. No, I just think that's a wonderful story. But in terms of Monty Lee, I think Ray Tanner is making sure I would think Coach Lee would understand that he's talking to everybody to make sure he makes the right decision, because Ray knows what we all know. He can't misfire this time with the baseball hire. And not saying that Monty Lee would be a misfire. He may turn out to be the best option they have. But I think he owes it to the program to make sure he checks out every option before deciding on somebody. I was interested, though, that John believes it could happen as early as this weekend, if not the latest first part of next week.
Yeah. And if it goes beyond that, then I think there's somebody in the College World Series.
I would agree.
But I just don't believe that he misfired the previous two times. I mean, getting to the College World Series, obviously, is everybody's goal. But it is so hard. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, again, under Holbrook, they went to 3 regionals in 5 years. Okay, it's a pretty good percentage. Under Kingston, they went to 4 regionals in 6 years.
Yeah.
Again, a pretty good percentage. I mean, that's winning baseball. But not good enough. I get it. Tanner built this monster of a baseball program that in the minds of the fans, and with today's social media pressure that you get and donors' pressure that you get, you know, if you're a South Carolina and you're not, or you're a Clemson and you're not winning regionals and going to the College World Series, changes are going to be made. Okay, let's hit the break, and we'll come back and hear from Eric Bakich as he talked with the media, and then we'll hear from Kevin O'Sullivan when he talked to the media outside his dugout after their practice today. It's a beautiful afternoon, a little toasty up here at Clemson, but right now there is not one single cloud in the sky. It's a beautiful South Carolina blue sky afternoon. And we'll hear from the coaches coming up. Be back. Jeff Owens will also join us. And, of course, George Bryan III and some recruiting. We'll be back.
This is Major Billy Downer with the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. Boating season is right around the corner here in the Palmetto State. As you get ready for this spring and summer, make sure your registration sticker is up to date and you have a copy of your registration card on board your boat. For more information on boat registration and answers to common questions, visit dnr.sc.gov.
Great things don't happen all at once. Big dreams take time. And when it comes to saving for college, it's those small steps that make a difference. I'm State Treasurer Curtis Loftus. Future Scholar, South Carolina's 529 College Savings Plan, is designed to be taken step by step. You can start with any amount, contributions are tax deductible, and earnings grow tax free. So why wait? Discover the smart, easy way to save for college at FutureScholar.com.
I'm attorney Jim Corbett. That's the sound of a big hit on you and your car or truck. I've been an attorney for more than 30 years, helping people who get injured in car wrecks and truck wrecks. If you have serious injuries, call Jim Corbett, 803-765-2968, or email me at jim@jimcorbettattorney.com. That's C-O-R-B-E-T-T. I don't get paid unless I recover for you. Jim Corbett Attorney, for your best recovery from a big hit, 803-765-2968, or jim@jimcorbettattorney.com.
Last throw, big guy.
Come on, baby. I need me a giant bear.
I got this. I am the target.
Ben, throw.
Yes! Oh, wow. Look who won a giant bear.
That's a grizzly.
Oh, mama's baby bear.
When you join the South Carolina Education Lottery's Players Club, you get way more than you expect. More chances, more wins, and more surprises.
Yeah, he's had all his shots. Just don't look him in the eye.
Join the Players Club at seeducationlottery.com because more happens here.
Eric Backich, Clemson's head coach, second year in a super regional, and he met with the media up in the Clemson meeting room, players meeting room, above the first baseline here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium, one of their new pieces to Doug Kingsmore Stadium they built a few years ago. So let's listen to what the coach had to say to the media a few hours ago.
Eric, what do you know about Florida? What have you seen out of them so far?
Know a lot. They're obviously an outstanding program. This year's team is, you know, maybe not unusual from the caliber of talent that they have, but maybe unusual with just their overall record. But I think what we saw in the regional is the team that they are and everyone thought they would be at the beginning of the year. So, you know, the regular season and their record in the regular season has means absolutely nothing. And all that matters is they won the regional. They're playing well. They probably were a lot of people unsure if, you know, if they were going to get in, and they got in, and that's going to be a mentally freeing type of feeling. So I think I'm sure they feel like they've got house money, and they capitalized on that in the regional, and they're, you know, we expect they're hot, and they're coming in here with a lot of confidence, and we know it's going to be a huge challenge for us, especially given the caliber of their players.
Speaking of Florida, did you get a chance to say hello to Coach O'Sullivan yet and catch up about the good old days?
No. I don't imagine we'll be doing that.
What do you remember about that year working alongside him, and what was such an incredible staff here that Coach Larry assembled?
I just remember, you know, recognizing, like, you don't usually recognize when you're at the right place at the right time and very lucky. It's usually something you reflect back upon, but I just remember recognizing that in the moment. You know, Tim Corbin was just named the National Assistant Coach of the Year, was just with the Team USA staff, which, you know, usually you don't see many assistant coaches on Team USA. And you know, obviously everyone knows Coach Leggett and knew, you know, the type of head coach that he was, but I think it was instantly recognizable that I was sharing an office with two assistant coaches who were going to go off to be outstanding Hall of Fame head coaches as well. And, you know, just being in that office with them, like, maybe that's what I didn't recognize, how lucky I was to share an office with those two guys. But I did know that these are two of the best of the very best to ever do it in college baseball, plus Coach Leggett. So it's just, you know, couldn't have asked for a better opportunity. And that's why I have such reverence for Clemson, because this is my first ever coaching job and coaching opportunity, and, you know, changed the trajectory of my life, which is why I, you know, jumped at the opportunity to come back here, because I hold the, you know, this place in such high regard, almost like a player would feel about their alma mater is how I feel about this place. You know, it just draws up those same feelings I have when I start thinking about my time at East Carolina and playing for Keith LeClair, who was part of Jack Leggett's coaching tree. So it's all connected, and it's just, you know, that staff and that year and those players and the season that we had, it's all part of those feelings.
Eric, you alluded to the confidence that Florida's going to have on the diamond this week, but describe your bunch's confidence that you guys have going into this one.
Yeah, our guys are feeling good. They're fired up. I mean, you know, everyone's confident who's made it to this level. Everyone's coming off a regional championship, so how could you not be confident? And we feel especially confident just because our guys have been consistent. You know, not just the season, but, you know, from the day one of the fall, what they've done off the field as well as on the field, you know, how they've competed in the classroom, how they've served the community, as well as the consistency. Maybe not every week. We've had a, you know, couple of slip-ups here and there, but our guys, from a preparation standpoint, have been hyper-competitive and ultra-consistent. And as a coaching staff and as a program and as Team 127, we couldn't ask for anything more. And, you know, draw a lot of confidence just from our preparation, knowing that we're ready. It's time to let it rip. Yep.
As far as Florida, just the team that hits a lot of home runs and playing in a stadium of these dimensions, like, how important is it going to be just the pitchers locating, not giving them balls to hit out of the yard?
Yeah, it's a good point, because it's not just Caglione with his 31, but Shelton's got 20, and you got a bunch of other guys with double digits. So it's a dangerous lineup, you know, top to bottom, a lot of home run threats in there. So, yeah, we'll definitely have to be competitive, and if they hit a home run, you know, we'll take it. You know, they can earn that, but what we don't want is to couple that with free passes or errors or things like that. So we've been doing a pretty good job lately of not beating ourselves and being pretty stingy from a pitching and defense standpoint, and we will absolutely have to do that with a team like this and a caliber of this offense with the power threats.
We talk so much about
the atmosphere is going to be pretty crazy here tomorrow. They have to open up the softball stadium to kind of get the overflow traffic. This is what you came here for, I imagine, to see this kind of scene.
Yeah, this is awesome. I mean, we definitely have a whole nother standard deviation of attendance possibilities here. You know, 6,000 is great, 10,000 is better. And I think this is one of those programs that has that level where we could, you know, certainly achieve 50% more capacity. And, you know, weekends like last weekend proved that. And I can't wait to see the energy in the stadium. That was the best college baseball environment in all my years of being a part of college baseball that I've ever seen. I felt like I was in a rock concert with Journey song playing and the cell phone flashlights, and that'll be burned into my brain forever. And I know we've got 2 day games, so we won't see that again, but that
Florida's pitching helped come up the Oklahoma State in the regional finals. So what challenge do they present to you guys?
It's all pro prospects with power stuff. I mean, the guy tomorrow tops out at 98. The guy after that's also upper 90s. So you got Peterson and Caglione, who are upper 90s stuff with swing and miss offerings. And then everyone in the bullpen is a mid-90s type of pitcher. I mean, they just roll out one power arm prospect after the next. So, you know, they swung it and they pitched well, and they had to do it the hard way through the loser's bracket last weekend. But they did enough at the end. They kept a good hitting Oklahoma State team to just 2 runs in both those final games, and that's really tough to do at their park with the offense that they have, because it's a very offensive park. And so what they did in those games in the regional last weekend was super impressive. But it's a testament to just kind of how they're playing and how they're feeling right now.
Eric, I know you didn't come here just to get to a Super Regional, but is there some sort of cathartic, emotional release about what you guys were able to accomplish last weekend and wiping that 2010 out of the lexicon around here?
I think so. I think that's what you chase. You chase celebratory moments. And if you have a chance to beat South Carolina, that's a celebratory moment. If you have a chance to win the ACC, that's worth celebrating. And then any championship after that, whether it's a tournament championship, a regional, a super regional, a national, you know, those are the things that you want for these guys, and you got to earn it every day, starting from the first team meeting in August. You have to, you know, just it takes what it takes, and you got to be, you know, committed to that routine and have that discipline, and our guys have. So every kind of checkpoint along the way, when we have a chance to call ourselves a champion of a segment throughout the course of the season and keep writing our story, we want to celebrate it. We want to enjoy it, and we're happy about it, but we're not satisfied, and we want to keep going. A special atmosphere, and just again, thank you to the Clemson community who made it happen, because they made it happen. You got students up in the balcony over there, like, you know, created their own additional student section. It's just, you know, a lot of authentic, cool things that are happening, and I expect this weekend will be no different. We're going to have great weather. We're going to have plenty of people out, and we've got all kinds of room, not just the softball stadium. You got the turf field. I mean, if people want to come hang out, let's make it one gigantic party like those students did in the balcony over there. Let's get a few thousand more like that and just make it a like concert meets carnival meets baseball game. So,
all right, there you go. Eric Backich talking to us this afternoon. Carnival meets baseball, Chris. That's what he wants. Carnival meets baseball.
To keep an eye, and if they start trying to license club DKS, I want some royalty out of that.
That's your idea.
You heard it here first, but that's exactly what he wants, and that's exactly what they got last weekend.
Well, it was rowdy last week. It'll be off the chains here this weekend. Be back
no
after
doubt.
The break. Don't go away.
Welcome back to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. You can reach the guys with the South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number, 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now back to Phil and Chris with a second hour of Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network.
Okay, we continue from up at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. It's quiet now. It's going to be rowdy tomorrow, and Clemson fans packed this place around 2 o'clock. Tigers and Florida for the first game of the Super Regional. Two wins, and you're on your way to Omaha. Florida, of course, I mean, like, they've got their own private headquarters in Omaha. They've been there 8 times under Kevin O'Sullivan. That's pretty amazing. 8 times. He left here as Clemson's associate head coach, pitching coach, back in 09, I think it was, to go to Florida, and has built quite the program. Won national championship. He lost in one championship final to South Carolina. Lost in another championship final last year to LSU in 3 games. They beat LSU when they won their national championship back in 2017. So he's obviously
That's the amazing thing, Phil, not to interrupt, but you mentioned 8 trips to the College World Series. It sort of lends credence to how difficult it is and how we may hold an unrealistic expectation and standard to both Clemson and South Carolina baseball, not just getting in the NCAA tournament, but they've gone to the CWS 8 times, and they've only won it once. I mean, that's a remarkable stat.
Yeah. Well, Florida State never won it. And how many times did Mike Martin take a team to Omaha, you know, and never won it? So, anyway, after they wrapped up their practice today, the media had a chance to gather around Sully in front of the Florida dugout. He was wearing an orange top, by the way, to go along. Somebody asked him about why he was wearing an orange top. He goes, well, orange is one of our colors. He says, orange is one of our colors. He goes, and the guy goes, well, I mean, all your other guys are wearing the blue. He goes, well, I don't ask my players what they're wearing, and I just grab what I want to grab. You know, in other words, it had nothing to do with him being back at Clemson, that he was donning orange. It's a different shade of orange compared to the Clemson orange. Here is Sully talking about being back at Clemson. First time he has been back here since he left, not even for a casual visit. First time back. He talks about that and more.
No, I was just excited to have the opportunity to play this weekend. Obviously, there's a bit surreal to be back in Clemson after 17 years of not coming back. But, no, we're excited. We know we're playing a really good team with Clemson and looking forward to tomorrow.
I wanted to ask just what are the emotions, what are the feelings when you get to walk back out here and think back to all those memories of back in the day?
You know, it's hard to put in words right now because, you know, I literally, this is the first time we've been back. I didn't even stop by here yesterday, but you know, really just focused on our own team. And, you know, I've thought a lot about, you know, what it might feel like, but I don't want this to be about me, or obviously there'll be a lot of discussions about me and Jack and Eric, of course. But, you know, focus is really about our team right now.
Have you been able to talk to Jack at all since you've been?
I saw him before practice. Yeah, took a couple pictures together.
Same guy. Can't believe he's still here, can you?
No, I can believe he's still here, but it's great to see him. I still stay in touch with him quite a bit.
Did he give you any inside scouting information?
Absolutely not. I can't even get him to go out to dinner with me right now.
What have you told your outfielders about the warning track here?
Yeah, we did talk about it, we spent quite a bit of time during practice about it. It's not as steep as I thought it was going to be, as it used to be, anyways. But we took the outfielders in 3 different groups and threw them some balls up the hill, and then we took some balls off the machine, and then we did about 15 minutes of live defense. So I feel like they're, you know, they're a bit more prepared than I thought they would be coming in, because it used to obviously be a bit steeper. So I think we should be fine.
Kevin, the confidence of your team has got to be high after going into a hostile environment and coming out of Oklahoma State with a victory.
Yeah, I mean, Oklahoma State was outstanding. I mean, they ran arm after arm after arm out there. They've got probably 3 or 4 hitters in their lineup that will probably play in the big leagues. It was a hostile environment. But, you know, we played 3 games in about 28 hours. And, you know, I think it's been well scripted that we've maybe have underachieved quite a bit this year. But, you know, we played obviously a really difficult schedule, and we played in some really tough places, you know, Arkansas, LSU. I mean, you know, you go play Florida State 3 times. I mean, you look up and down our schedule, there's quite a few places that are really difficult to play, and I think that helped probably prepare us for last weekend.
Where did you feel like you guys made the most progress on the mound last weekend, just with how much success you guys had compared to the weeks before that?
Honestly, I think it probably started with Liam Peterson trying to figure things out. You know, we finally found one guy that can get us into the 6th or 7th inning. So now you're not overextending your bullpen, and guys are being asked to do what they're capable of doing. But when you have starts that are 3 2/3 or, you know, 4 1/3 and you're going to your bullpen too early on a Friday night, that affects Saturday and obviously affects Sunday. So I think it all starts with Liam being able to extend the game, you know, on that Friday night and first start.
On the other side, just what do you see in scouting Clemson and the solid season they've had so far leading up to this?
I'm going to do some more tonight, but obviously they're older. They're athletic. They got some length to their lineup. And I've known Jimmy for a long time, and all of his staffs have always thrown strikes and had the ability to throw multiple pitches for strikes. And, they could slow the ball down in fastball counts. And obviously they're playing with a lot of energy. I know they've had like maybe 25 come from behind wins this year. The team chemistry from an outside looking in looks like it's as good as it could be. And they don't beat themselves. So, you know, it should be a fun series. Both teams, I think, are going to play fundamentally sound. And it's like anything else. It'll come down to a pitch here and a bat here. And whoever has the opportunity to rise in those certain situations is probably going to end up, being the winner. But, I mean, it should be a well-played series for sure.
You guys have worked with Fisher Jameson a lot over the last 2 years. Just how much has he been able to be like a steady, reliable arm out of the bullpen for you guys?
Yeah, he's our unsung hero on the mound. And it's easy for people to possibly overlook him. But in my eyes, I trust him. Obviously, his last outing on Monday was as good as he's ever pitched, you know, facing 10 hitters and retiring all 10. But you could just see his confidence level different last Monday. But for me personally, he's been our most reliable pitcher all year long.
Coach, what's the relationship like now between you and Coach Bakich?
It's great. I mean, we've always been great friends. I mean, think about it. We all work together with Jack and obviously Tim at Vanderbilt. So I'm looking forward to seeing him tomorrow.
He was obviously the younger guy in the room with you guys. Did y'all like make him go do lunch runs for you, go get drinks, wash your car?
No, nothing like that. I'd just say there was quite a bit of testosterone in that one office. Three very competitive guys.
Coach, I know you're against him, but what has it been like to see the success of Coach Bakich with this team this season?
I mean, honestly, I think he was the perfect fit for Clemson. And people had asked me when they were, going through the search, and I don't think there was anybody else that was probably even should be considered on the list. I knew he would be a perfect fit here. And obviously he's had tremendous success.
Did you choose to wear the orange on purpose for practice today? Or?
We're orange too.
No, I know. Pretty much everyone else is wearing blue today, and I noticed you're wearing the orange. Kind of stood out from everybody. I didn't know.
Well, I don't really talk to the players what they're wearing. I just put on what I want to put on.
Eric said earlier that he knew back in 2002 that there were two Hall of Fame assistants eventually out there. Did you see the same out of Eric? Did you see that from you and Tim?
Yeah, I mean, Eric, he's always had energy. He's smart. He's very detail-oriented. And what he did at Michigan, I mean, think about it. He played for a national championship against him. I mean, so if you're able to do that at a place like Michigan, he's certainly going to have more success in an environment like this, for sure.
How much of an impact did Jack have on your career and where you are now as a head coach?
I mean, everything, honestly. I mean, I was young. I was probably about 28 years old, I guess, when Jack asked me, to come on board as his pitching coach. When you're young, you always focus on the X's and O's and all those types of things. But, to run a program like this, there's so much more that's involved, in the organization and, the academic piece. And, now being around Jack and learning how to run a program from A to Z, really has prepared us for all this portal stuff and NIL stuff, and there's constant changes. But, I obviously owe everything to Jack.
The Sports Talk Recruiting Report is sponsored by Seawells Catering.
All right, you heard the comments from the Kevin O'Sullivan, Florida baseball coach, a great recruiter, of course, in his own rights. Great lead into our recruiting report tonight, brought to you by Seawells. Remind you got a special event coming up needing the professionals in the catering business. You want to give Seawells a call, 803-771-7385, and don't forget the daily lunch and buffet all next week. All right, athlete Jaquel Holman, Blackville Hilda, did not make it to Clemson for camp this week. He had kind of banged up his ankle riding his bicycle and did not want to go and compete when he wasn't healthy. So he passed on that, but he will be at South Carolina tomorrow with his parents. He wants them to meet Shane Beamer. He was at camp at South Carolina last week. He picked up an offer from the Gamecocks there. Says he's not yet ready to commit because he's getting more and more interest and he wants to see what else is out there. So he's not going to rush anything. And he said South Carolina has been very patient with him and he appreciates that. He's got an official to Liberty next week and Pittsburgh wants him to come to a camp before he sets up an official visit there. Not sure he's going to do that, but they are talking with him and South Carolina said he can visit officially there anytime that he wants to. Defensive end Jaquavius Dodd of Eastside camped at Clemson earlier this week. The Tigers haven't offered. He has an offer from USC, but he's not going to camp there this summer. He's taking an official to Virginia this weekend, and then he has UConn and Virginia Tech scheduled for official visits the next 2 weekends. Officials at USC this weekend, cornerback Brandon Finney. Defensive end Kobe Saki-Praw. Defensive tackle Kevin Wynn. Linebacker A.J. Holloway. Offensive tackle Juan Gaston. Safety LaGonza Hayward. Safety Christopher Hatfield. Tight end Preston Douglas. Committed receiver Brian Rowe. And wide receiver Lex Cyrus. Some in-state visits this weekend. Onus Konenbanny from Heathwood, the cornerback, going to North Carolina. Rock Hill receiver Malik Clark going to North Carolina. Mentioned that Dodd is going to Virginia. And Irmo quarterback A.J. Brand is going to Virginia Tech. Some other scheduled visits this weekend for Clemson targets. Defensive end Bryce Davis to Duke. He's also a USC target. Receiver Cortez Mills to Florida. Offensive guard Max Buchanan. Safety Jordan Young, Florida State. Defensive tackle Christian Garrett. Offensive tackle David Sanders to Georgia. Sanders also a USC target. Receiver Samari Reed to Kentucky. Defensive tackle Elijah Griffin, Miami. Safety Anquan Fagans, Miami. Offensive tackle Mario Nash, Ole Miss. Linebacker Kamar Archie, Texas A&M. And offensive tackle Hardy Watts, Wisconsin. And Gamecock targets visits this weekend. Defensive tackle Eric Thomas, Syracuse. Defensive end Tayshawn Alston, Rutgers. Linebacker Jaden Breaker to Rutgers. Receiver Winston Watkins to Ole Miss. Linebacker Jadon Blair, Notre Dame. Linebacker Nathaniel Owusu-Boateng, Notre Dame. Defensive tackle Bryce Jenkins to Maryland. Offensive center Isaac Soles to Kentucky. Running back Sean Cuono to Indiana. Linebacker Donovan Darden, Illinois. Defensive end Jared Smith, Georgia. Safety Jonte Gilbert, Georgia. Offensive tackle Damola Ajadon to Duke. Ajadahan. Damola Ajadahan to Duke. Offensive guard Jacob Ward to Auburn. And Clemson target, cornerback Donovan Starr of Brentwood, Tennessee, committed to Auburn. And Clemson basketball offered 6'5", Isaiah Dennis of Davidson, North Carolina. And the Tigers also got a basketball commitment this afternoon, or maybe it was last night. Rob Jackson, he's a 7-footer from IMG Academy. And apparently, from what we can gather, it might be just a walk-on situation, but he's a big walk-on, a 7-footer, and he posted that he's going to go to Clemson. There you go with recruiting tonight here on Sports Talk. We'll keep an eye on things over the weekend. Anything breaks, of course, we'll put it out on Twitter at SportsTalkSC. Use the hashtag STRecruiting and on our website, SportsTalkSC.com. After the break, we take a break from the baseball talk. We turn to NASCAR. NASCAR is heading out west to Sonoma. Catch up with Jeff Owens on that. And at the bottom of the hour, birdies, bogeys, and biceps with George Brian III. We'll be back in just a moment.
Relax this summer with a promotional rate on select travel purchases with your Founders Federal Credit Union credit card. Now through August 31st, get 6.99% APR for 6 months on qualifying purchases, including airfare, hotels, restaurants, and cruise lines.
Don't let interest rates slow you down this summer. Visit foundersfcu.com/travel to learn more. Not a Founders member yet? Founders has the financial tools you need and the personalized service you deserve. Stop by an office or visit foundersfcu.com to learn more about Founders and see if you qualify for membership. On March 1st, 2025, the promotional APR will revert to the effective APR as previously disclosed. Call 800-845-1644 for details about credit costs and terms. Membership qualification required.
You've put in the work for your education. The extra early, extra late, extra work. That's because you understand education opens doors to better pay, better opportunities, and a better you. Being educated about playing the lottery is no different. It helps you be a better player, one who knows when to play and when to take a rain check. The lottery's a game, so let's keep it fun. Learn more at sceducationlottery.com/betteryou.
George Bryant here with Tsunami Bar Sports, and wow, Tsunami Robbie, there is now an amazing technology that you can use when you train receiving large game without having to endure pain. Please explain.
George, that is the magic combination. I have three simple words to define that entire concept. Stimulation, not annihilation. Regardless of your training goals, there is a level of stimulation that is optimal for your desired gains. Tsunami Bar's flexible bar technology meets these demands because the user determines the level of stimulation with the amount of speed and force they impart into the bar or training device.
Hey, this is Phil Kornblut. The Tsunami Bar is a terrific training device whether you're working on your fitness or your golf game. It's convenient, it's easy to use, and you won't feel beat up afterwards. Be sure to click on the digital ad on sportstalksc.com and get 5% off any order using promo code BBB5. Don't wait. Order today.
Love it when it's four wide. Love it when it's fast. Love it when the leaders call the pack is moving past. Love it when they're making lots and lots of noise. Can't wait to hear these W's say.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, boys.
Let's go racing, boys. Love it when they're drafting. Love it when they slide. Love it when the back.
Boogity, 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 boogity. Let's go racing, boys. All right, we welcome in Jeff Owens into the fast lane here on Sports Talk on this Friday night. We always talk NASCAR this time of the program. NASCAR fans around the state can't wait to hear what Jeff has to say about what is coming up this weekend in NASCAR. Welcome in, sir. Good to have you with us. Before we look ahead, pretty active week, NASCAR front. With the race last weekend outside of St. Louis, surprise winner there. And then Kyle Larson having his, his reinstatement so that he can participate in the playoffs coming down early in the week. Your thoughts on those two events from the last few days?
Yeah, not a great race at Gateway, obviously, last week. You always hate to see a race end in fuel mileage, Phil. I mean, it's just, you know, it's racing. You know, you don't want to see them riding around lifting the throttle and trying to save fuel. But it happens. You know, it's part of racing, but it just sort of saps the momentum out of everything. You know, we'd had some great races, great finishes earlier in the year, and a lot of drama, a nice fight a couple of weeks ago, and now we got to kill it with a fuel mileage race. but at least we had a little bit of drama there. I mean, Ryan Blaney looked like they played the strategy perfectly, and he was going to win the race. And then surprisingly, he runs out of gas. I mean, they thought they were good, and they came up a little bit short. Run out of fuel, and his teammate Austin Cindric winds up winning the race. So the Penske cars definitely had things figured out from a fuel mileage perspective, and the race sort of played in their hands. So tough break for Blaney. Austin Cindric sort of lucks into the victory, and now he's got a win, and he's in the playoffs hunt. So good day for Penske Racing there. The Larson thing, not real surprised. I think they had to grant that waiver. I think it would have been awful had they not done that, as we talked about last week. I mean, you know, Kyle Larson couldn't do anything at all about the weather and the way things played out, and he brought a tremendous amount of exposure and publicity to the sport by trying to run that double. So I just think it would have been wrong to not grant him that waiver, and fortunately they did the right thing.
Do you know at this point if he plans to try to do it again next year?
Well, I think he could now. He certainly could now once they've resolved this. I don't think they've announced that yet. It certainly wouldn't surprise me. I think he had a great time doing it, and he was competitive. I don't know that he was going to win the race, but he was running sixth when they pitted under green, and he got a pit road speeding penalty. And basically that occurred because he had not made a green flag pit stop the entire time he'd been up there in practice or anything. So just a mistake. I would not be surprised at all if they don't try that again.
Jeff Owens in the fast lane with us here tonight on Sports Talk. And Jeff, news out yesterday that Front Row Motorsports is going to buy one of the charters from Stuart Haas Racing, paying $20 to $25 million for that, and that evidently is a bargain because of the amount of charters that are available. For those of us who aren't plugged in immediately into NASCAR, what exactly is the difference between being a team owner or a car owner versus buying a charter from another team? How does that – I'm assuming that's another race car for Front Row Motorsports, but what makes it different since it's a charter from Stuart Haas?
Yeah, well, a charter is basically your franchise. That's basically what it is. It's a team, and it's your franchise to own and operate that team. And that was something NASCAR did years ago, because basically what owners were finding out is when they went to sell these teams or to get out of the sport, they had nothing of value to sell. So a charter, you know, is a franchise, and it guarantees you you're going to be in every race, and it has other perks, financial perks, that come with it. And that was kind of one of the benefits of Stuart Haas getting out of the sport. They're able to sell. They had four teams, so they're able to sell those four charters and at least recoup some of their investments. So that's the plan. Front Row Motorsports was widely rumored to be one of the teams that was going to purchase a charter. There's some other teams that are lining up to do the same thing, including Denny Hamlin and Michael Jordan's team. If you want to start a new team now, that's the way to go do it, is to purchase a charter from somebody else, which guarantees your sponsors you're going to be in a race. So good move by them, and I think they're going to – I think Stuart Haas will wind up selling the other three here in the coming weeks and probably get about the same amount of money.
Couple more minutes with Jeff Owens in the fast lane here on Sports Talk. They had about a 50-minute practice at Sonoma today, and Ryan Blaney led the way. Do you think he'll run out of gas on the white flag lap? Come race day, are they going to have the gas figured out? We've seen people run out of gas at Sonoma before. Wasn't it Marcos Ambrose who was like going to win for the first time, and they were telling him to turn off the car to save gas, and the car wouldn't turn back on or something?
Yeah, I think that happened to him twice out there, actually. He stalled on the track one time. It's very common out there because, you know, road courses are much longer tracks than we see on the ovals. I think Sonoma's about 2.5 miles, something like that. It's not out of the question at all, and we're almost guaranteed to see another fuel mileage race in some form or fashion, because that's part of the game out there on the road courses. You know, you try to figure out the strategy and you try to run far enough that you can have one fewer pit stop than everybody else. And when they cycle through, ideally you come back at the front. So there'll be a lot of fuel mileage strategy played out there. There will be guys that'll probably run out of gas. And, hopefully you get a late caution and it at least bunches the field up and they can race for it. But fuel mileage will be a huge factor out there. And inevitably, there will be somebody who will run out and it'll probably cost somebody. So hope it's not Blaney 2 weeks in a row.
Hey, Jeff, we appreciate you, man. Thanks for being with us. Have a terrific weekend. I know you're going to be tuned into these regionals as well. And we'll talk to you next week. Thanks for joining us, Jeff.
Thanks, guys. Have a good weekend.
You too. All right, my man Jeff Owens in the fast lane. Coming up, George Bryan the third. Now two removed from the end of the Brian legacy after the newcomer this week. We'll be back.
Four. Straight down the middle. It went straight down the middle. Then it started to hook just a wee bit. And that's when my caddy lost sight of it. That little white pellet has never been found to this day. But it went straight down the middle.
All right, time to welcome in our man on the links, George Brian the Third, who now ranks two spots behind the future king of the Brian family. We'll let George officially introduce to the Sports Talk world the newest member of the Brian family, more important than any trophy that anybody could win, more important than a U.S. Open, a PGA, and anything else, because this week the Brian family welcomed George Brian the Fifth. Way to go, George. I know you had very little to do at this particular time. Somewhere down the line, you had something to do with it. But, man, GB5 is here.
Yeah, that's
right. Congrats.
I didn't expect that. I am quite humbled and a mom and G5. I've just been calling him Five. They are very healthy, and I still can't believe he did it. I cannot believe he did it. I thought they were kidding. And then we got five grand girls, and I just assumed that this would be another girl. Five out of seven until G5 made the third boy. And anyway, it's a bit overwhelming. One grandchild, as you know, well, for me, one is overwhelming, but eight is where we are now. And G5's doing great. They live in Aiken.
That's almost a baseball team. You need well, if you're counting a DH, you need two more. So you're short a right fielder and a DH, I'd say.
Yeah, well, and I hadn't even thought about that. I have been somewhere between shutdown and cockeyed. My head's spinning with all this stuff that goes on. And this is my favorite time of year. We got golf everywhere. And I did enjoy, by the way, I listened to earlier to your show, baseball with Florida and a little bit from the Clemson coach. And I'll tell you what, I've always loved baseball. But incidentally, at least a couple of folks listened. I guess it was last week maybe. I made some comments about baseball and golf. And anyway, I didn't mean anything ugly when I made the comment about baseball coaches ought to let their kids play golf. That's just my opinion. I think it's just a ball and a stick sport, and learn to hit them both and you'll be better at both. How about that? But I did enjoy that segment with the Florida and the Clemson coach earlier. Good job with that.
Thank you. Now, George, have you ever been late for your tee time? Because tonight on Sports Talk, the Corn, for the first time in his life, was actually late to his tee time because my computer clock said it was 5:05 when it was actually 6:05. Can you believe that? I was disqualified. I had to beg the rules officials, Chris and Josh, to let me play. So you were almost without me tonight.
Well, hey, thank you, Chris and Josh. Josh is such a fine young gentleman. He always is a great greeting on the phone. And Chris, yeah, appreciate that. I have gotten two stroke penalty, and I've gotten DQ'd. Hap Lathrop, we chuckled about that in our last conversation, and my thoughts and prayers are with Hap. He's recovering. He had a little bit of a challenge to deal with, but last time I talked to Hap, we were talking about the fact that I got DQ'd. So there, at the time, if the players in your group hit the second shot, then you had no chance, DQ. Well, I'm standing there going, I wonder who that is in the fairway. And I said it out loud, and Hap turns around and goes, Well, that's your group, George, and I guess you just DQ'd. You just figured out you are disqualified. Where have you been? I went, well, I was eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich because I was hungry. He goes, well, go back to your car. You got time to eat another one.
Which brings
me
to...
Wait a minute. So if you're not on the tee box, you could literally catch up with your group if they had just hit their tee shots?
Well, back in the day, this was at a U.S. Open qualifier at Spring Valley in 1985 or 6, and the rules have since probably changed a little bit, but yeah.
Okay.
So I missed my tee time, and I was hungry. I just sat down and ate, and I didn't look at my clock. I just knew I could eat. Once I started eating, I must have went into some sort of euphoria state. Anyhow, I was chomping on that peanut butter and jelly, and I get to the tee, and I said, you know, that looks just like the guys I played with this morning. Because they are. Where you been?
Which brings me to my topic. It brings me to my topic off of this tonight. George Bryan with us, Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps, brought to you by Tsunami Bar Sports. Check them out online at our website. You can click on the link to Tsunami Bar Sports. Learn all about them. Chris Road in West Columbia. Go by and see him. You'd be amazed with what you see. What is your advice to the amateur, you know, the guy going out to play his round? Like, what is your rule of thumb for arriving at the course? Now, Chris is playing tomorrow. He's going to go down and play at the beach. I won't name the course because I don't want a bunch of people running out there. But he's going to be playing down at the beach tomorrow. Unfortunately, I have to work, so I'm not playing golf. But what is your advice or your rule of thumb for getting to the club, you know, getting your car parked, getting your clubs out, and getting into your warm-up phase before you go to your round? What is your rule of thumb?
Well, for everybody's a little different, but a 7 o'clock – what time's your tee time, Chris?
1:12 eyeball time, I know, but that's what it is.
It's going to be 95 degrees,
too. It's going to be hot.
No,
yeah.
Well, I just listened to y'all's forecast just before we got on. It's supposed to be 90, which is a lot different than 95. And the wind will be out of the southwest, and it'll be cool. Hey, so if you want 1:12, you know, at least get there at 30 minutes before. I'd say 45 minutes. So you get checked in, hydrate a little bit, and then break into a little bit of a warm-up. Get your body ready before you begin to swing the golf club at a golf ball. You know, how you might get your body ready, it varies from one person to the next, but if it's some dynamic movements to get a little blood flowing to, obviously, the Tsunami Bar technology is just amazing because just a little bit goes a long way. Dr. Vince Mizmara has actually – made the comment on numerous occasions, just need a little bit to get blood flow going. And so something to get blood flow so your muscles are a little bit warm before you swing at a golf ball with a golf club. So I'd say if you don't have bands, if you don't have any technology, something to at least do a few deep knee bends, do a few stretches of your choice. I always love pretend swings. Just pretend like you swinging at the golf ball. And I'd say 3 to 5 to 6 minutes of just basic warm up for your body. Now get the club out. Some folks grab two of them at a time, go swing that for a few, very light and slow to start with. If you're going to do it that way, I always suggest go light on the next rep. So drop those two clubs. Turn the club upside down in what I call whoosh swings. Get the butt end of that club, the grip end, to whistle a little bit. So you soften up, lighten up those arms, and somewhere in the now you've snuck up to the 145. Don't forget to check in and pay your green fees, unless you're playing with somebody like Phil, who's going to be the kind host and take care of it, or check in, make sure you use the SportsTalk expense account, Birdies and Bogeys, of course, and use your credit card there. Get to the hit a few putts first, then smack 8, 10, 15 balls on the range always use the range as just somewhere to loosen up, get the club on the ball. It's not, it doesn't count, so you don't need to get too serious, excited if you hit them good, or upset if you don't hit them good. It's just a place to warm up, trying to get the club on the ball. And I, last thing to do is get too serious and worked up in a warm up. So,
well, I
from
see
there,
people sometimes coming
of
off the.
I mean, it does.
I see people sometimes, George. You know, they're coming off the practice tee and they're like, they're drenched in sweat. I mean, no, it's a hot day, let's say, or it's a hot morning or warm, and you're gonna, and it's humid, and you're gonna sweat some. But I mean, like, they've really burned a lot of fuel on the practice tee. Is that wise? Can that affect you, you know, later in the day in your round? You start kind of wearing down a little bit?
Oh, absolutely. We get so excited. I've been guilty in that a number of times. But in the summer, it doesn't take much. Even if you had some nutrition and you're watered up and have hydrated, dadgummit, it's still exciting. You get out there 30, 45 minutes early and hit your 40, 50, 60 shots, and you leave it all on the range. So definitely don't do that. If you're somebody who plays 3 or 4 times a week, you can probably get away with hitting more than about 15 or 20 balls. But if you're just somebody playing once a week, once every couple of weeks, all you need is a dozen, 15 quality shots, and you should go to the tee. Do not leave all those good shots at the range. I'm telling you, that is just not the right idea.
But psychologically, like, you want your last range shot to be a really good one, right? You want to carry, like, a positive feel to the first tee?
You know, everybody's a little different with that. Dr. Bob Rotella gave me the advice, and then Jay Haas said the same thing. We're talking going back to the 80s. Jay Haas, I've already shared this before. He said, hey, George, I just didn't want to get loose hitting golf balls. And so I started getting my body ready before I swung at the first ball. It made a huge difference, huge difference. Then Dr. Bob Rotella slammed the door on it and said, now, George, and I talked to both of them about how to get off to better starts. At that time, I was a professional, and all I can tell you, if you start off slow in pro golf, they lap you. And I was notorious starting off 2-3 over after 5 holes because I was so nervous and excited. But Dr. Bob said, hey, just use it as a bit of a steel trap, just a place to get loose. And if you hit it good, then you take it onto the golf course. But if you don't hit it good, hey, remember it, not one shot counts against you. And flip it around, go upside down, and say, well, you hit it terrible on the range, that means you're going to hit it great on the course. Mm. But it doesn't count. So I don't get stuck and don't even recommend anybody go down that path of you got to hit the last one good before you go to the tee. In fact, go ahead and catch it on the toe or the heel the next one's got to be solid.
That's easy, so, and that's easy to say and easy to do. I can promise you that. All right, let me get to the tournaments we got going on. Of course, the Open at Pinehurst is next week. We got the Memorial this week. Let me do the scores, and then we'll talk about this. Scottie Scheffler, hello, he's back. He's your leader. Yes, he is. He's your leader. He's at 9 under, 67, 68. And then Adam Hadwin, Victor Hovland, they are at 6 under, 72 and 69, respectively. Christian Bezuidenhout, 5 under after a 67. Keegan Bradley, a 69. He's 5 under. That's the top of the leaderboard. Rory, 3 under after a 71. Xander Schauffele, 3 under after a 73. And let's see, Justin Thomas, he's at plus 4. He made the cut after a 77. Jordan Spieth missed the cut. Wyndham Clark missed the cut. Lucas Glover, 74. He missed the cut. Ricky Fowler, they all missed the cut. I want to go to the BMW Pro-Am in a moment. But, you know, this is Jack's tournament, the Memorial, and it's also supposed to be, obviously, something done in honor of Jack Nicklaus, one of the all-time greats. But it seems to me like it kind of gets lost here, maybe the week before the Open. I know they play it around Memorial Day, or try to play it around Memorial Day. But, I mean, I don't know. What do you think? Does this tournament still hold the prestige that it used to, or does it lose a little something here being so close to the Open?
You know, I cannot recall it being this far away from Memorial Day to start with. And mm-hmm. I don't think there's any question that what you just said carries some weight. And quite frankly, I'm rather disappointed. Don't understand. And this snuck up on me and was quite a surprise. So all I can tell you is it's been a while since it's been this far away from Memorial Day. But I haven't heard what the great Golden Bear has spoken of it. I haven't picked up on that yet. And so, but I am kind of, I'm just stunned that it sits where it is in the schedule. And I have not, like I said, I haven't listened to what the great Golden Bear himself has said.
Mm-hmm. All right. Over in Greenville, we've got
actually,
the annual.
Phil, if you don't mind, mm-hmm. if I can follow up on what George just said, Nicholas is evidently not really happy. Because he commented earlier this week, when I played, I rarely played a week before any major championship, so I'm asked to be putting on a golf tournament in a weekend, which I'd never play. Mm. So he's hoping it would revert back to maybe earlier on the schedule moving forward.
Close to Memorial Day would make a lot of mm-hmm. sense. All right, yep. The BMW Charity Pro-Am presented by TD Synex, or Synex, up in Greenville. They're playing the Carolina Country Club. And they're playing at Thornblade, and you have Seth Reeves, 64-64. That's 15 under. Ryan Girard, 64-66, 13 under. Billy Kennerly, 68-62, George, 62 at Thornblade today for him. That's some good playing, 13 under. Here's Bill Haas. Of course, he should do well at Thornblade. That's his home course, a 63 after a 67. He's at 13 under. So there you go. That's the top of the leaderboard there. What do you think of this event? Have you ever played in it? You ever attempted to play in it?
You know, believe it or not, I played in this event when it was the Ben Hogan Tour and the Nike Tour. Way back in the day, it was not at the same golf courses. Those are beautiful, beautiful golf courses that they're playing, and we played at Verde Greens. I tell you what, at this level, I was also looking at Jonathan Bird at 7 under. Seth Reeves, a lefty, who absolutely pounds on it. And so Thornblade, it's Thornblade. I know that's
Carolina
Thornblade.
Country Club. Carolina Country Club, just those two. Mm-hmm.
Okay, those are fabulous golf courses, but at this level, a lot of folks will go, you know, kind of questionable, not sure. These folks are fantastic. Bill Haas, he's a former FedEx Cup champion,
yeah.
And like I was looking down the Kennerly, a great player from Clemson, and let's see, somebody else I noticed.
Well, let me give you the locals. Let me give you the locals besides Bill. Matt Atkins had a 69 after a 66. He's 8 under. You mentioned Jay Bird. He's at 7 under. Kyle Stanley, a pair of 69s. He's at 5. Bryson Nimmer, he's at 5 under, pair of 69s, and missing the cut at 3 under, Chris Baker. Tommy Gainey misses the cut at 2 under, 70-71. Sam Saunders misses the cut at -1. And William McGirt misses the cut at even par.
Well, and that's I know McGirt's probably disappointed with that. Those are golf courses he knows very, very well. I was speaking, we had the Mitsubishi rep at Salina Golf Club yesterday, and he was kind of talking about the strength of the field. And all I can tell you is I wish I could have figured out how to get up there and go. We're opening up 18 holes this weekend at Salina Golf Club.
No way. Time out. You're going to have the full 18?
Exactly. And you will have a chance to come out and set the course record just like you did at the Scramble course.
Oh, my gosh.
And won't that be fun? Won't that be fun?
And I want a plaque over the – have you got a bridge over water that you have to take at any point?
Do we have a bridge over water for Phil Kornblut? Oh, you know we do, and it is a gorgeous bridge, and there's plenty of room for a plaque, man. It's a 100-foot bridge.
That's great. That's great. Let me give you
one
local note.
I did like the new golf carts, though, George.
Oh, did you see the golf carts that we got? At least a couple of them are in. So, yeah, those will be pretty cool, too.
All right, let me give you one SCGA note here. End of last month, towards the end of last month, the 57th SCGA four-ball championship, George. And we had Garland Farrell and Robbie Beershank. Robbie Beershank still winning golf tournaments. They won second consecutive year against a team of Chris and Evan Easy. Farrell and Beershank won two up, and they played that at Musgrove Mill, beautiful golf course there. So Robbie Beershank and the Beershanks, they can still hit it a mile, can't they? Can he still hit it a mile?
Oh, all the Beershanks hit it awesome. And I had the privilege in 1982 when Dillard Pruitt won the South Carolina Amateur at Chanticleer. I got paired in the paired the last two rounds with Tommy Beershank Senior. And what a privilege it is there. What a great golfing family. And everyone, if your last name's Beershank, you can just play golf. That's a fact.
Yeah, so really.
We talked a lot about them over the years, and not just we go back long enough to talk about Beershanks and junior golf, amateur golf, college golf, and even pro golf. I mean, Tommy, his kid played on the tour for several years. So, like I said, all the Beershanks can play.
All right, I got to ask you one more question before you leave us. One more question. So, we have GB5 now with us, George Brian the Fifth. Have you guys, you and GB4, have y'all had a chance to talk to him about, hey, you know, one day now, will you be interested in having a GB6, which sounds sort of like a British underworld security agency, but you're going to address that with him, that you want a GB6 somewhere down the road?
You know, I don't even know how to react to that. You're the first one to ever ask me about it. I'm so taken back that they went ahead with number five, and I thought there was enough. I thought there were enough fours. I thought there was enough with me. My wife goes, nope, we're naming him. He's going to be a fourth. And then, it's very confusing. A lot of Georges. In fact, we at the hospital down in Augusta, one of the nurses said, I can't remember anybody being named George here.
Well, you better go find that kid.
That's the old name right there, and it's not one that's not a lot of Georges out there, I guess. But
I guess.
Now there's a five. There's a five. And I tell you what, I went out to play the scramble to shut it down on the way. I was on the way home, and I just couldn't stand it. Had to go out. You can play six holes in less than 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And the scramble is, with 96% open, we keep having little slight delays one way or another. We had one of our key folks go down with a back injury, and we 96% finished, but we will have some cool announcements. 6 minutes to play. Technically, I played three balls a hole, played the worst of three tonight, and I got a little work to do on my wedges, but I played in less than 10 minutes. So we also have the Garage Sports Gym that will be open hopefully soon, and then obviously the Tsunami Bar Training Center. More later. It's been a privilege. Can't wait to see how this college baseball shakes out. And then Memorial. And next week's the Open. Until next time, enjoyed it tonight. TM High, but shoot them low, man.
Same here, George.
Thanks, George.
We'll get out to see you once we get all this baseball behind us. Thank you, GB. God, he's only number three, GB3, George Brian the Third. Need to mention, of course, for those who aren't aware, Celtics won last night, first game of the NBA Finals.
Porzingis looked good, didn't he, in his return?
Did. I like him coming off the bench, too.
Evidently, he does as well. I heard his comments afterwards, and he said, I'm just here to do whatever I can to help the team. That's the kind of guy you want.
What defense around the rim, too, between Brown and him. That was awesome. Okay, great way to end it. Thank you, everybody. Have a great weekend. Follow me here at Clemson, and we'll see you Monday.